So I'm Paul DeGarabedian, Senior Media Analyst for Comscore. And I'm going to call this Comscore's Filmmaker Focus because I have an incredible group of filmmakers joining me this evening. Nag Ashwin, the writer and director of Kalki 2898 AD, the fabled sci-fi action adventure, along with producers Priyanka Dutt and Swapna Dutt. Welcome to Filmmaker Focus. It's great to see all of you.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
So this is truly exciting. And as I've been looking over the past few weeks at the summer movie box office, it's been quite incredible to see your movie, Kalki 2898 AD, just be performing incredibly well. And it's emerged as only the seventh film in Indian film history to gross more than 1,000 crores, 10 billion rupees, equal to $120 million US, and has secured its place as the second highest grossing Indian film in North America ever. How does that feel for all of you? Beyond just the fact that it's had critical acclaim, so well received by audiences and critics, but just how does it feel to be on that world stage with your film?
It's fully a blessing. That's what we all feel, because when we make a film, we definitely want the largest audience possible to watch it. And the numbers are essentially reflective of that. So the bigger the number, the more people have watched it, the more people have watched it multiple times. Because in India, we have also a culture of people watching films like 7 or 8 times if they like it. So that love is a bit extreme. So we're extremely happy. And it's great to see a genre like this really kick off in North America as well.
That's so great. And Priyanka, what's this like for you as a producer on the film?
I think it's, because it's been a really long journey. It's almost like 4 years of, work on this. And just getting the numbers or getting those people to watch and like the reviews and everything is just, is like a payoff for the hard work that went into it. So it's a good feeling. It's definitely a good feeling.
Absolutely, Paul. I think, when the film was seeing the first sunrise, all we hoped that is that it has to be one of the greatest stories told, and so it's just all we wish that, people would accept it with open arms, but this is just extremely overwhelming. It's incredible, and
to wind up in the top 10 in the summer movie box office in North America is a big deal for any movie. I mean, it's a very competitive marketplace. And I've seen in our Comscore data over the past few years that Indian cinema has just become so profoundly embraced by audiences from all backgrounds. The art of what you've created, the passion for cinema is in every frame of your film. That's got to be incredibly gratifying that you're finding an audience beyond your borders, going global. And after the 4 years of work you put in, that's got to be like the greatest reward ever, like you said.
It is. When you see our story and you see somebody reacting from Southern California or like some small town in Arkansas or something, and they are loving the film as much as we did when we've been making it, and picking out points or pronouncing the names of our characters with as much love. It's awesome. It's awesome to see them love Kyra and, call Viran and Mariam by their names. And it's definitely great. It's been like that for a while. Like, India has been growing huge for like the American box office, like the movies that come into India are doing bigger and bigger numbers. And now the same seems to be happening the other side. So it feels great.
And you pulled off quite a casting coup of sorts by bringing together some of the biggest stars in India, a legendary artist. Can you mention some of those legendary actors, artists that are in your film?
I'd say almost all of them. Like, all of them are either in the legendary status or the newcomer status. There's no in between.
I'm gonna make you mention their names so I don't mispronounce them. Yeah. Do you understand what I'm doing?
No, I understand. So Well, first off, Mr. Amitabh Bachchan, who played Ashwadama, Kamal Hassan, who's played Yaskin, Prabhas, the Pika Padukone, they all are the biggest stars in their own categories right now. And even other than them, they're like, you know, Shashwata Chatterjee is a massive star in Calcutta. Shobhana Garu is a legend who played Mariam. Veeran is a super popular actor. So Rajendra Prasad Garu, who played Rumi, is a legend in Telugu cinema. So many Brahmanandam who played. I mean, I could go on this. This would fill up the interview.
I love that. And Swapna and Priyanka, for you both, I mean, going on set, interacting with these legendary stars, is it daunting? Do you get starstruck? As I know you're in the industry, but people, I mean, I know for me, I get starstruck by people in my industry, and by starstruck, I just mean, you get that, you know, overwhelming feeling of, wow, I'm talking to a legend. What's that dynamic like, both as producers and then as director?
For sure. We were super starstruck with Mr. Amitabh Bachchan. Because I remember he coming onto the set, and we were like, I mean, I remember I was just staring at him for at least for first couple of days, and is he in my set? Is it true? But later that it becomes because he's so then we get into making the film, and he's so punctual and he's so in it, then he becomes your actor. And But yeah, I definitely had a super star-struck moment with Mr. Bachchan. Yeah.
I love that. And Swapna, you?
I think it's pretty much the same. The first few schedules have just been is this real? But then you gradually get to work and, it becomes normal. But still, when my phone rings and I get emails from Mr. Bachchan or, Mr. Kamal Hassan, I'm like, wow, I actually have phone calls with with these people. So it's pretty unreal. And,
do you show people your phone? Oh, sorry to interrupt you, Swapna, but do you show people your phone and go, that's... Somebody really?
We show each other.
We show each other. We definitely flaunt to each other that we've done something right in life.
That's amazing. I love that. And Nag, I'm sure you feel the same.
As a director, I think my job is to just fully act as if I know what I'm doing. So that's especially with legends like this who've done 200, 300 films and, classic all-time box office hit films, I just have to put on that act even more. I have to
they say, just show that, exude that confidence on set and everyone will follow. And it's genre you've chosen to attack is to put on film is dystopian future sci-fi elements. I mean, this is it's one thing to make there's other genres that don't require, I would assume, as much budget or the type of effects, or even whether they be CGI or be practical effects, but you're blending sci-fi elements with ancient history, mythology. What's your process in that for those who are watching? And I mean, you don't have to give away the secret recipe or anything of what your process is, but what goes into all that when you take on a movie like this versus, let's say, if it was a comedy, a horror movie, a lower budgeted film that doesn't have all those effects required to bring that story to life?
It takes a lot of world building, the research that goes into it, the design team, the concept artists, the production designer, costumes. Each department has to do that extra amount of research and work. Mm-hmm. Because we're saying it's a future world, it doesn't exist. And especially in Indian cinema, there's no point of reference. Most of the time, we anyway don't want a point of reference because we want to be as original as possible. But in India, we didn't have a choice either. There's no film that's tried to do this sort of language. So we have a rich culture in the mythology space. We have a lot of films, a lot of comic books, paintings, and all of that gives us a good idea of how mythology and history was portrayed, but to merge that with how a dystopic future would be was a lot of back and forth and a lot of design zoom calls.
Do you do storyboarding? Is that part of your process?
We do, especially for the action scenes, because they're all pretty complicated. So we do a fair bit of storyboarding. Yeah. Everybody drop.
So Swapna and Priyanka, you are among a very special club of female producers who have produced films of this scale. What, you know, your effort is even more unique because yours is an independent production without any studio backing, as I understand it. How did you venture into this? It seems pretty risky. What drove you as producers to embark on this journey with this film? With Kalki 2898 AD?
I think to start off with, clearly it will be Nagi, Ashwin, an absolute confidence on his vision, on, you know, he's somebody that we'd blindly trust. And then the story itself, I think, which was phenomenal. After that, you know, whatever it takes to make a film like this is what was in, you know, what was running in our head. My father, our father, who's been in cinema for the last 50 years, has had the same goal. Whatever cinema takes is what we need to give. And fortunately, he leads this. And yeah, we could just walk in the same footsteps and get this done. Yeah.
And your father's a legend. And, you know, Priyanka, can you talk about your father a little bit? Tell the audience, for those, you know, who would love to know about this whole family-oriented production, tell us about your father.
So Dad's always been this person who only believes in the story. So that is definitely something that we kind of inherited from him while growing up. I mean, definitely he's made like a lot of films with like the biggest stars of India, biggest stars of Andhra, Tamil Nadu. But his core is his story, and his core is his music. He believes, I mean, he loves his music. He's like your proper Indian filmmaker. He loves his songs. He loves this huge set, like, you know, the art and all that. So he's your larger than life kind of a filmmaker. He's always been that. And I think we kind of grew up with that, and we come from that. And as I think, even for Kalki, what is the thing that, why did we take it forward, such a humongous project, is the story, for sure, the story and the world. That as producers, as you know, we were like, we got very excited. Like, I think that is something that we believe, like, we should get excited to watch this film, then we can make this film, is something that we believe in.
And your father, I mean, I don't mean to pry, but he's been in the business for decades, correct? And he's a legend, and he's a you know, kind of a patriarch of cinema, I would say, after all these years in the business. And Aswani, that's, I mean, for those who don't know, tell your father's name. So that's so awesome. I love that the family's involved, and Nag, you've got to be just so pleased to be a part of this. And I know in my own family, we have filmmakers, and it's really cool when it works, when everyone gets along and you know, but it's a collaborative process, but certainly it can be, there's a lot of pressure. And I don't know what it was like for you behind the scenes. You don't have to go into it, but it just seems like you've come out of this 4.5 years very bonded and very feeling more powerful than ever about your passion for film. And, you know, you started this project, like, was it like over 4 years, like 4.5 years ago? That was COVID times, I believe, for when you started this project. And a lot of people thought—
It was before COVID. I think we just sort of announced our project when one of our main leads came on board, and then the world stopped.
Wow. And you had to be like, wow, we're embarking on this. Will there be cinema? I mean, I remember in March of 2020, March 13, I remember the date is when, at least in the US, movie theaters shut down. And the box office went from here to almost zero. The good news was that a lot of people showed up to drive-ins, which meant they still wanted to see movies on the big screen. But for you as I mean, anyone working on anything right then, if you were building a restaurant or you were a resort or, you know, a destination, that had to be incredibly chilling. But it sounds like you just kept going. It was a long process anyway. You waited out things, or not waited out, but you arrived at the perfect moment, it seems. Those 4 years led you to this incredibly fortuitous time for your film. What was that like for you? Like, how did you address that moment?
There was definitely some sort of uncertainty on when it's going to start and how and stuff. But and also, I think this sort of a film, I think Ashwin needed a lot more support in terms of cumulative effort and stuff. But yeah, that was being a sort of something that I thoroughly thought he was missing. But then that's when the Zooms have been happening, and Priyanka and team and all of them were sitting on design and all that. Yeah, they found new avenues on how to work and take things forward, which was cool. And and then we started, and then there was another wave, and then we had to take a break again, and then we started again. So yeah, it went on for a while. Yeah,
I was happy because I was getting that time to to develop the story or to develop the design and stuff like that. So I we took the break. I mean, we took the break also. We used the break quite well. We've done a lot of back end work, and
And Nog, for you, it had to be like, oh man, we're just getting started, and now we got to deal with the pandemic. But look at the reward now that you've had. You know, so all these things happen for a reason, I assume, and we have to just believe that. But I want to talk about the 50 years for your production house, founded by your father, who we spoke of earlier, Ashwini Dutt. And he always believes in making films of scale. What does scale mean? I mean, we're using that term. It's used in finance. It's used in all different ways. But I think I know what we're talking about here. Filmic scale, cinematic scale. What does that mean? And you've made a lot of diverse films too. Coming of age film, biopic, a tiny comedy, that interfaith romance, and now this massive film for a global audience. Nog, is that the mission statement of your production house?
Yeah, we were, especially my father, someone who gets very excited with the scale of the film. I mean, most of the times, even we being the younger audience, or, you know, people who'd like go on sets and be like a bit immune to lots of green screens and things like that. But, you know, it was my father who just get extremely excited for a big stunt, or, you know, these actors in their costumes and roles. And he just gets so excited. And that would actually keep us going also to a large extent. Every time we hit a button up in terms of scale, he gets excited first. I mean, I think it should be vice versa. He should be actually getting scared, but he only gets excited with a
that.
New actor. He gets excited with a bigger scale, with bigger action episodes, with, you know, with adding a sequence or a song. He's the one who gets excited most of the time. Yeah,
I gotta meet this man. I'm telling you, I would love to meet him. Nog, does scale mean size and scope, budget? What does scale mean when we're talking about that? Is it a money thing, or is it just the vision? How big is the vision? Or is it a combination?
I'd say the vision of the story, maybe the scale of the story is what I'd say. Definitely it includes the visuals and everything that come with it. But for me, it feels like if a billion people can watch the film, that's a big scale film. That means that so many people are able to understand or love or connect with that film. So that I feel is scale, because like the classic ones that we even watch right now, like in India, Ben-Hur is still a massive film. Like my grandmother's era would still talk about Ben-Hur. So that is scale for me. It's I don't know the budget of Ben-Hur. I don't know the box office of Ben-Hur.
Yeah.
I have no idea, right? But it's the same. It's only that I feel is the scale. So that's what we hope to achieve.
Well, I feel like watching your film, your filmmaking, you know, your canvas feels to me like Cinerama, you know, back in the day, Super Panavision, you know, those like Lawrence of Arabia, Ben-Hur, those kind of those movies that fill the every inch of that screen, like Stanley Kubrick. If you watch 2001, you see all these details. But really, for me, and I'm sure you agree, on the big screen in the movie theater, the communal part of it, and I know every filmmaker I know, and it should be this way, wants to see their film on that biggest possible screen in that communal environment of a movie theater, whether it be in India, like, you know, Arkansas, California, no matter where it is. That's like, again, that global love for cinema. For filmmakers such as yourselves, how important is that big screen? I mean, obviously all movies big screen wind up at some point on the small screen, which is great because not everyone can get to a cinema or whatever. But when you're in this shining moment where that film is in the theater, that's got to be incredibly gratifying. Do you, when you were producing the film, Swapna, I'll start with you, did you envision what it would be like for moviegoers in the theater? Or are you making the movie you're going to make and it kind of will become that larger than life movie?
Like I was saying, Paul, I think after a particular point, we've become very immune to what we were, and it was so much green screens and we were caught up with our own regular thing of pulling off that scene or sending the actors on time and things like that. But I think when I watched something on the edit, like, you know, on a very low scale of CGI, I was like, oh, wow, this is what Nagi was actually making. This is what we were actually making. So that was one moment which I went back to Priyanka and my father and I said, damn, I think this is world class. I felt like if, you know, his vision comes right and this will be something that definitely just not India, but some of the world would have never seen. And, you know, what he could pull off in terms of, you know, his vision and with the little resources we would have compared to what like a global platform would have. I think it's incredible and it's a very, very proud moment. And especially watching it cumulatively in a theater when people are just not yelling or shouting for the actors, but when they see a scene and they'd be like, ooh, like that sort of a thing comes up. And, you know, it's the, you know, then if they're talking about the scene itself, you know, it's just not actors and demigods, they're talking about the background, the world and everything. So that's very gratifying.
And Priyanka, do you go to the theater multiple times with an audience and sit in the back and kind of watch, or is that, and Nag as well, is that part of your process or just part of your fun and watching audiences fall in love with your film?
The first I do go for all my movies, but the first few times, I mean, first one, two shows is very nerve-wracking for me. It's like if someone takes out a phone or someone moves, I'm like either getting bored, oh my God, what is this and all that. So for this film, I just went once the first day and it was too much for me. It's the same feeling. So then I kind of went after 2 days after, you know, the whole, the reports were pouring in, all the critics were pouring in, the collections were pouring in. I was like, oh my God, okay, now I'm like, I'm fine. Like, and then I went, but I still had the same feeling, but it's a little lesser. But I went last week and I thoroughly enjoyed because I don't have it anymore. Like I'm like, I was watching with like a full theater and I had a great time.
I usually don't watch my film immediately, try to hide and usually not go for a few days because it's too fresh. Probably I've seen it like thousands of times. I would probably still see a lot of things that I could or should have fixed. So I usually don't do that. But this film, I think on the second day, all three of us went and we wanted to see the audience, see it with the audience. And it was great because by then people had already seen the film multiple times and they were screaming and they were preempting jokes and entries and dialogues. It's good. Good.
Yeah. I would imagine,
I just wanted to say that.
Yeah, please.
Definitely, you know, biggest screen, we all want to see the film on the biggest screen, but I think we were very, I was very lucky that, you know, we were allowed to shoot on the Alexa 65. So it was a very expensive, rare camera.
Can you explain that real quick to people who don't know what that is?
It's essentially an IMAX camera in a digital format, like, you know, like what Lawrence of Arabia was shot on. would have been a 70mm film camera. Mm-hmm. But now we have a 70mm digital camera, and there are very few of them in the world. And we thought, obviously, optimistically, we thought we'll finish shoot very soon. So we brought it down, and mm-hmm. we ended up blocking it for a couple of years. And, you know, it's a full privilege to be able to shoot on that camera. And wow. I wouldn't be surprised if that's a small reason why this film looks so special or beautiful.
Yeah, it's very funny that I keep telling Nagashwin that, well, you're working with someone who's not very technically sound, who's not very solid in CGI, who's not seen so much of this sort of cinema. So, yeah, so everything was a learning for us. I mean, this is something that we heard from him. And we got excited along and we started work. So, yeah. It was the director's call, and then, like I said, it needs what it needs.
I really have no idea what this camera is. I mean, still, like, I mean, if someone asks me, like, the technicalities, I'm like, I really don't know. I have to check with someone. I still don't know, but what he told me is, like, if supposed to be, like, flown from the US, I mean, I was like, might be good for the film. That's the only feeling that I went with this camera.
And I remember day one when the camera landed, when they were testing and they needed like somebody to be on the test. I said, I'd just go do it. And I saw myself looking very nice. So I thought, okay, this camera is definitely doing some magic.
Wow. That's amazing. And, you know, you think back to when they shot Dr. Zhivago or Lawrence of Arabia, Ben-Hur, when they were using film, I mean, like film, and then having to print it, get it processed. Incredible. Digital just seems to me, you know, there used to be this big argument about against digital. And I know some filmmakers want to shoot only on film, like a chemically processed film. But it seems to me when in the right hands, you're using their tools in a toolbox. If you know how to use them, Nog, I'm sure you felt this way. It probably just kind of opened a lot of creative freedom for you to not have to worry about some of the aspects that you would have if it was actual physical film, chemical film.
Yeah. I mean, I love film. Like in our previous film, again, in Mahanati, the biopic, I sort of was allowed by the production to use 16mm film, which was great. I loved it. And it came with its own set of challenges and logistical issues. But this film, with so much VFX, it makes no sense to shoot on film.
Right.
It's just a redundant process. But anything in real life, I would still prefer shooting on film. Yeah, I'm a little old school.
And I've heard that from a lot of filmmakers. Also, too, you're partners with the cinema operators. I mean, in the sense that you've put all this work into the sound and vision. You want it to be presented or exhibited the best possible way. Do you talk to the theater owners? Do you talk to their projectionists? I mean,
especially in India, I think, at a stage where cinema has been in the last few months, they've been waiting for a film like this to come in. In fact, there was a period where all the theaters have been shut off because there weren't films running, and then they were all just waiting to reopen for this film. So it's pretty much like, you know, a bride getting ready for the for the wedding. And it was just amazing on how they were all so excited, the theaters. So you would obviously trust that they show it in the best way and best format. And globally, I think they pretty much are very prepared for this sort of cinema. And I think those norms are very clearly followed.
Have you seen Indian cinema evolving on the global stage? How does your educational background, yet your background, your culture come into play? It seems like those two things have melded in a very profound way. And I'll ask you first on that.
We've definitely been exposed by the time that maybe we studied, but even in India, we've been exposed to a lot of Hollywood films that come in, release, and I think growing up for us, the way the world looked at Indian cinema was, it was the song and dance, it was the Bollywood musical, it was that. And I think what has happened in the last 5 years, maybe, is that has changed to an extent. It's like it's been called Indian cinema and not Bollywood, just, you know,
right?
Which I think is great, like, you know, because because India is like so many industries and each of them are so unique. The actors are so unique. The stories are so unique. And now we're just slowly coming together as Indian cinema. We yeah. love our song and dance. We love the colorful musicals, but it's just one part of Indian cinema. And we just are showing different parts of Indian cinema to the world. And I think it's just opening, you know, it's just like one of those animations where the door opens and now, you know, we get to see what's inside.
And I've noticed too that, you know, where people used to use Bollywood as a catch-all for every film from India. And I kind of get that. I mean, people didn't know. They need to be educated. And if there weren't a lot of films from India being played 20 years ago or even 15 or 10 years ago in, let's say, the U.S. market. But now when I talk to people, maybe I'm talking to the right people when I'm doing this or people who know. But it seems that audiences know the difference now. One thing that's really cool that kind of plays into this, the global part of it is, yours was the first Indian film to ever be unveiled at San Diego Comic-Con, the big deal, the big Comic-Con in 2023. Your film was the yeah. first to be unveiled at Comic-Con in San Diego. What were your thoughts on doing this? And did it help position your film for success? That had to be, I mean, that was a great achievement to get on that stage and on that screen in San Diego. And Swapna, did you all work on that to get that to happen? If you wouldn't mind, to whatever extent you're willing to share the behind the scenes on that of getting into Comic-Con.
You know, again, it's a learning. When Nagi said, I think this is a film which could actually kickstart in Comic-Con, we were like, yeah, wow, Comic-Con, yeah, let's give it a shot. And then pitch the film, obviously. And, you know, obviously it's a process. Priyanka's got through the process. And then we were all set for a global stage. Then we realized it's too early for us because our release is at least a year later and or probably 8 months later. And then we thought, no, why not? Like, you know, because there's nothing from the film which has been showcased till that moment. Nobody knew what the film was except for the star cast. So we did our first teaser there. And I don't really know if it helped the positioning of the film. It had, you know, but it was a great kickstart to take something like that, you know, on a global platform and show, listen, hi, we're from India and we're making this sort of a film. Is a phenomenal kick to get started with. It's a kick for life. Like, yeah.
And Priyanka.
After Nagi told us, then we researched a little bit and then we got to know about this place called Hall H, where, you know, all this big films and you know, get selected to play there, like show their glimpse. And we kind of luckily got into Hall H,
the big hall, it's huge.
And the quality is amazing, the quality of the screen and the audio, everything. And then when we went there, we were like, okay, so now it's the first Indian film. Nobody knows us. We're not Marvel. We're nobody. And so getting the 4,000 seats filled was like, we're like, is it going to happen? Are they going to come? Like, because who's going to come? And then we started like dressing up in our, so we had like a Raiders, you know, playing the cosplay, and we had our people dressed up in saris and just going out and like informing people about it. And we were still 10th. And like before 10 minutes before they opened the gates, it was full. We had a huge line, and 4,000 people were just sitting there And so that's something, that's an experience. It's not you're not your typical Indian people. They're like people from all over.
Yeah.
And we
all
had,
over. And honestly, by the time we got into Comic-Con, by the time our film was showcased in Comic-Con, all the tickets were sold. So literally the Indian fans couldn't actually buy the tickets. So it's pretty much like, listen, that's a fear that we've had. But then when the doors opened, it was another story altogether. Yeah.
It's wow. Another story
and
altogether.
And that had to be insane. Like 4,000 people. I mean, and it seems to me that Comic-Con is a perfect venue for Indian cinema.
It surely was, because I mean, I sort of follow this to a certain extent because I love Star Wars and Marvel and all of that. And we can only hope that our work is talked about in the same space. I just have to say that, you know, I have suggestions and ideas, but like to make it happen is like a whole different ball game. And the fact that, you know, when we were standing backstage and, you know, there was a little bit of an intro and then they call the actors and they call us on stage. I think that was a fully surreal moment that we're actually going to walk on stage in front of this Comic-Con background that we've seen Marvel actors in front of for years.
Yeah.
We're going to do that. We're going to walk out. We're going to say hi to this crowd of people who probably don't know us at all, but they're just waiting to see what we're here to present. And it's definitely one small piece of history and one core memory for all of us.
Oh, that's incredible. And by the way, you know, that could be a very tough crowd too.
It is. Like, that's what we heard.
It could go a variety of ways there, and it has for some filmmakers and films. So that certainly had to be like, oh my God. And then you're like rock stars going out on stage there. That's
we
incredible.
Heard. And no, I think that's the first time anybody saw anything from the film. So it was hearts in our mouths anyway. And the fact that it was in San Diego Comic-Con was just that little extra.
I'm getting the chills just thinking about
it. And there was so much excitement when people were like wooing and asking for the trailer to be played again. I'm like, wow. And then right after that, by evening, I mean, there were great reviews pouring in. People were talking about it and we were like, yes, this is a great moment for the film to start off.
Well fucking done. That is great.
The trailer was awesome.
Definitely a great teaser.
I'll definitely go see it.
I'm super excited to see it.
It's like the next level.
Really good.
I am excited.
Very interesting to see the international occasion of Indian cinema.
Blown away.
Great to see a Telugu movie.
Oh, it's wonderful.
I really liked it.
It's insane.
I'm really excited.
Yeah.
It was an amazing trailer.
We caught the spear as well.
Special effects, really great.
Amazing.
I'm really excited to watch it.
What's action time?
Really exciting.
Really great.
It looks amazing.
It was great. I'm very excited to see it.
But that was certainly a very, huge event for the film, and what a great way to present it to the world. And did you work with a specific marketing person? Did you do this yourselves? What was the marketing? What was the calculus for that? And obviously, Comic-Con certainly was a part of the marketing of the film. So Priyanka, what...
For Comic-Con, we pretty much did it ourselves in a way. Like, we had, because it was our first time and we kind of did it ourselves. And we had like just few people just help us, you know, just to do some minimum stuff. But it was pretty much us who did. But next Comic-Con, whenever we go, we're going to go all out maybe, because we know... more about it now,
man. I will be there on the next one. I promise. I will be in San Diego to greet you there. I want to talk about an AI vehicle called Bujji. Yeah.
The time saddened Bujji.
Probably one of the most important characters in the film as well, because it's the only one that Bhairava seems to like really care about and react to when something happens to it. So it's definitely an important one. I mean, it's essentially a vehicle. It's got its voice that comes from a little AI bot, but we call the whole thing Bujji as well. It's a vehicle. Its backstory is that it used to be part of the complex and it crashed, and now Bhairava made another body for it, which it's not very happy about.
I'm still in shock. We've broken all rules of engineering.
India's leading car manufacturer helped you to put this together?
Yeah, definitely. The logistics of it, and they put us on. There was a couple of companies that helped us build it. There was a team of designers. Like, the entire COVID was spent in, easily hundreds of Zoom calls with this designer from China, our production team, concept artists. And then we did a lot of engineering, which we never thought we wanted to, but we did. And then we figured out how to make that car work.
Yeah, that's really cool. I want to talk about your...
It could get a spin-off if people wanted, but yeah.
Okay. Oh, that's great.
We introduced him as the fifth character of the film.
We did like a comic series on it before the release of the film, like a prelude on the relationship between Bujji and Bhairava. And so it was everything about this film was unconventional. Even for as makers, we were like, it's very different, everything works well. But then when you look back and look at everything that we've done for the film, I think we kind of showed how a film could be treated than the regular commercial formatted marketing stuff. I feel the reach that the film has had in pockets, which probably will not go to cinema the day one, which probably they will wait for OTT. Another generation of audience, the younger generation, would be like, let's test waters and then go. We bought in those people to the theater. I totally give it to this the marketing strategy. Yeah, I think something that about marketing also, when we were talking, I mean, especially for this film and size of this film, we did everything unconventionally. We did nothing conventional. Let it be like a hardcore trailer or songs or things like that. We didn't do that route at all. We did Comic-Con, which is international, and then we launched the car, which is not the main screen.
The car is a character in the film. It's the companion to the protagonist. Okay. Yeah, that's so cool.
Yeah.
That's
and
awesome.
It talks. It's a character. It talks to him. It just makes jokes on him. Yeah. It's proper. It's its friend. It's pretty much it's a fifth character.
And you know, is there anything you can't do because you've launched an animated prequel? That's very unique for an Indian film. Talk about that. How did this idea come about? And you've launched it in Spanish language.
Quédate con el nombre de esta película porque lo va a petar en todo el mundo.
Hablo de Kalki 2898 AD. Además, ya está disponible una serie de animación sobre la película en Amazon Prime para ir conociendo todo el universo de Kalki 2898.
Es que Kalki 2898 AD ha generado una enorme expectación y pretende petarlo a lo largo del mundo.
I really want more Spanish people to see it still, but yeah. Yeah, there were a few things. I think when I started writing or started getting into making this film, I really wanted to do. And, thank God, thank everybody that it actually happened, whether it was Comic-Con, whether it was the fact that the animated show will release before the film. It was something I really wanted to happen. So there were a lot of things that happened like that. They were all wish lists. I don't know how we managed to write and direct and finish animated series along with the film, but we somehow did it. And I think it made a big impact. Like, I think just a few days ago, we had like some like one of the tracker websites that was saying that that was one of the most watched South Indian shows in the first half of the year. So that's a big thing for an animated show. It's competing with live action.
It seems like you know exactly what the audience wants, or you know what appeals to you, and it just so happens that you're in this on the same wavelength as the audience. Because it seems like so far you've just absolutely, you know, pitch perfect in terms of your creative vision, how you're executing it, the way you're world building and creating prequels and, you know, animated films and all of this. It seems like literally the sky's the limit. And, you know, you look at Hollywood, Greek mythology is so often used either tangentially or directly in movies. Indian mythology is incredible. Isn't that like opens a whole avenue, a whole like a creative outlet or a way to show Indian mythology through film, maybe that a lot of people are not familiar with outside of India? What are your thoughts on creating more cinema? Or
I think as kids also, we grew up watching Indian mythology in terms of, you know, it used to be a big tradition back in India. Before the satellite channels and all would come in, Doordarshan used to play something called Mahabharat at 10 o'clock Sunday morning, and used to start be like Mahabharat. And everybody in the street would just disappear, you know, from kids to the elders to everybody would just stick to television at that point of time. So I think there's some sort of, you know, obviously all of us kind of have a bit of it in our stream of thoughts and our lives. And then when we got an opportunity, you know, to be a part of Indian mythology in our storytelling, we were like super kicked, and we thought, you know, what else better? And the way Nagi's designed this whole thing and had to tell the new generation on what our Indian mythology is all about was very interesting. And I feel it's going to pay a lot of avenues into this. A lot of people are going to now start thinking and talking about mythology. And we were just reading somewhere that now apparently lots of Indian mytho books are being sold and people are reading about it. A lot of YouTube stories are being digged out. People want to know about Ashwadhama. Kids want to know about Karna. So these are, I think, you know, he's pulled off something extremely great. I mean, you know, yeah.
That's extraordinary. Are you going to be casting top international or Hollywood artist stars in sequels to the film to go more global or have global appeal? Is that something that's on the wish list, or is it whatever makes sense for the film?
Yeah. I think it's usually whatever makes sense for the film, whatever makes sense for the character first. I try to be pretty unconventional or a little surprising with the casting, because don't want it to feel like, you know, obviously this guy is going to be in this role, you know, like, so, no. But yeah, that's, but yeah, I mean, we'd love to see if there's any possibility, but right now, it's just for whoever's good for the role.
That makes sense. And, you know, these stories are so epic. You have this epic storyline, so many characters. It seems like you could just do sequels or have a multiverse. I don't know what term I would apply to it, but it just seems that you could have a franchise. Dare I say it could be a $1 billion Indian franchise. I don't think that would be outside the realm of possibility. Has that ever crossed your mind? How does that work into your, you know, your production philosophy?
I think the thought process has just been on, you know, doing absolute justice to put this film together and put it out. And now after that, let the story take its own turns, and, you know, let the world build I wouldn't say by itself, but, you know, on Nagi's vision on what he wants to do with, you know, with the spin-offs or the characters. And, you know, I certainly think there's a huge scope. I definitely think set up the world rolling, and, you know, now it's sky's the limit on what you could do with it. And I think our next biggest priority would be to roll the part two, because the film ends on a cliffhanger, and the most importantly, need to finish that storytelling. And I'd like to also understand on what is there in Nagashwin's head to know how he's planning to build this world further.
And would 4 years be required for each movie, or...
I don't think he would agree with that. No.
Yeah.
I mean, if it does, I'm in. I'm here for it. You know. You know. This does feel like Avengers, Star Wars, Mad Max, like those types of.
I remember. I think very early on, like when I pitched the movie to these guys, I was really excited. Like this was back in the day. Like super excited, and I was like literally barging into the room saying, "You guys, do you realize what all this could be? Like how many parts?" And they were like, we don't know. Like we have to see this movie. We don't know. Like it could go into merchandising. It can go into this. It can be like spin-off, prequel, sequels." They were like, "Yeah, I think that excitement." I mean, I started off with that thought process.
Yeah.
And now it's just a reality check of like what it takes to build it. But when you before building it,
you could dub Kalki in a bunch of languages and do an international version, like dubbed in various languages ahead of the second film. Would that be something on the table?
I think we would do that for sure. Yeah.
That's really cool.
Just to get more people ready for the next one. Yeah.
One last key question. How do you feel that Comscore adds value to what you do in international cinema and Indian cinema? I have to ask that. I just, you know.
I love numbers. I just love seeing numbers, graphs, patterns. So for me, it's like the best thing ever. Like it's the best tool. Love to see like what event affected what in the box office, like what we could have done differently, which region, which show. And that's what you guys do. You break it down to that level of detail. And so I know like in a certain region, because it's raining, the morning show probably didn't do as well. And like, I just love to get into those kind of details. Like, so I don't know if it's learning or if it's just understanding. So yeah, I was very excited to know that we were speaking to you today because I'm a fan.
We love the numbers too, but the thing is, well, I'm your biggest fan, and Raj Kumar on our team, you know, and he shares a passion for movies as I do.
Besides the analytics and stuff, I mean, what we as producers really, really love Comscore about and want something like Comscore or Comscore to, you know, to come in, to venture into India is because of transparency. Yeah. I mean, you know, we'd like to know what's being made, which theaters have how many shows and things like that. Unfortunately, I think still we're a bit behind in terms of in Indian market. So I've been pushing Rajkumar says, like, when is Comscore starting in India? When are they kickstarting in India? That should start soon.
No, that's awesome. I mean, I think too, for all of us at Comscore in the movies division in particular, we all love movies. I mean, in the numbers are just an expression of, you know, the popularity of films.
And also the numbers are the ones which are very rewarding, right? Like, you know, they're the measuring tape of what the cinema is.
Especially when they're really good numbers like you, especially when they're really great numbers like you guys got on Kalki 2898 AD. And it's been such an honor to have the filmmaking team behind the mega global hit from India, from director Nagi Ashwin, and he's the writer, director on the film, and producers Priyanka Dutt, Swapna Dutt, and of course their amazing father Aswani Dutt. So I want to thank you for being here on Comscore's Filmmaker Focus. Look out for more of these in the future, and I appreciate everyone watching. Come back soon. We'll see you at the movies.